Gentlemen, please be seated. We are about to begin our session, The Birth of Two Nations. Please switch off your mobile phones or put them on silent mode. There will be a question and answer session at the end of the discussion. We would appreciate if complete silence is observed when the session is in progress. Our esteemed participants for this session are Dr. Ayesha Jalal, Mr. Sayeed Hasan Khan, and Mr. Roger Long. Our moderator for this session is Haris Khalique, who is a leading poet writing in both Urdu and English. With 8 collections of verse to his credit, he also writes non-fiction, besides contributing regularly to literary and news publications. Within Pakistan and internationally, his work has been anthologized by Oxford University Press, SAARC Writers Forum, Pakistan Academy of Letters, University of Georgia Press, W.W. Norton and Company, and Penguin US, among others. Mr. Haris Khalique.
Thank you very much. Thank you for that generous introduction. I thought the panelists, deserve that kind of introduction, but they are so very well known that I will move directly to our conversation, to the subject of today. And ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here, all of you. And what we were discussing just before the panel started with Professor Jalal and Nawab Sayeed Hasan Khan Saab and Roger Long, Dr. Roger Long, that we are going to have more time for an interactive question answer session, but the questions will have to be brief and to the point. Because this is the theme and the subject that we have all been discussing because of the 70th anniversary, birth anniversary as it were, of Pakistan. For the last 3 days we have been discussing the subject, we have been on the subject. So I think it is an opportunity for us, because this is probably the concluding session on partition and on independence of India and Pakistan. So I'll ask the esteemed panelists, I'll pose one simple, straightforward question to start the conversation, kick off the conversation, and then we can have a couple of other questions, and then we'll come to you. My simple, humble question is...
Yes, what is the question?
Yeah, the simple question is that the title of this discussion, this talk, panel, is Birth of Two Nations. Was that a birth of two nations? Or was that a birth of two states? Because there is a difference. And I asked that question particularly because people who were... Because that also clashes with the two nation theory. Because two nations, South Asian Muslims were one nation. So how come Indian Muslims on the 15th of August have become another nation, and we are a distinct another nation? So, these are a little complicated issues which remain unresolved. If I may ask that question, and if I may request Professor Jalal to begin.
Well, I think you're absolutely right that there is a difference between a nation and a state. And I think there's the error that is made is that anybody who articulates nationalist perspectives, that there's a direct linear trajectory from nation to statehood. In this case, the idea of Muslim nationalism was raised on behalf of all Indian Muslims, but as you just pointed out, this Pakistani homeland, the homeland that was created, did not include all the Muslims of India. So in that sense, the two-nation theory, a la Hindu and Muslim, it was distorted in that prism of partition and ended up with two nation states, India and Pakistan, which split the Muslims between these two entities. So I think that's basically the confusion, that the two nations that we talk today are India and Pakistan and not necessarily Hindus and Muslims. And yet, much of the sort of molding of this, much of the discourse ends up being about Hindu and Muslim. And we tend to forget that it actually is about the two nation states that were created, i.e. India and Pakistan.
Right. Sayeed Hasan Khan, sir.
I have a feeling that it was not the birth of two states, but it was the birth of three nations. The third nation was already in the pregnancy, which was Bangladesh. At that time, Jinnah asked Sohrawardi, when he was talking about United Bengal, to talk about it, and he said to him that, after all, what is Bengal without Calcutta? So he started, and Kiran Shankar Roy, leader of the Congress Party, and Bose family, they were with him for United Bengal. But as usual, Congress Working Committee intervened, and the Marwadi influence on Gandhi prevailed, and it was rejected. So there was no chance for that. There was partition of Bengal there, and then a decision was forced on Jinnah for the partition of the remaining part of it. In that, what Jinnah did, he realized it that if he rejects this June 3 plan, then it will be a bigger disaster for Muslims. So he had to accept it. And when he realized it, in my opinion, the two people who were sorry at the independence, one was Gandhi and the other was Jinnah. But Jinnah could withdraw like Gandhi to a cave at that time. But Jinnah had to stand up, and he came down and he tried to resurrect whatever was left at his 11th August speech. Not only that, but he went further and he asked the editor of a newspaper, Sharma, not to migrate to India, and he said, "I want your help." So he said, "What will I do now? People are migrating." He said, "No, I will do the same thing which I did in India, fighting for minority rights." But on 6 January, riots took place. And according to Sharma in his book, Jinnah visited the refugee camp in Karachi, and there were tears in his eyes. And he made arrangement for Sharma to go. And by the time Jinnah died, the people who took over and the narration which took over about the partition is ruling till today.
Professor Long.
I think there were many factors that went into the creation of Pakistan in 1947, and Dr. Jalal has written about these factors. As a historian, one can look at these things in the long durée, in the long duration, and in the long duration we have seen the rise of nation states around the world, and in Pakistan's case it was much more the state than the nation. Pakistan, the movement for Pakistan, was also an ethnogenesis movement. And this ethnogenesis movement can be based on many things, can be based on religion, it can be based on language, it can be based on region, and the Pakistan movement can be interpreted as an ethnogenesis movement. And these ethnogenesis movements occur when there is a land, a territory, when there is a number of people, and when there is some kind of ideology that binds people together. And of course, Pakistan had all of these ingredients in 1947. I think there were quite a number of factors that caused Pakistan to be created in 1947. Obviously, one was the sole spokesman, the leader that many Muslims around the countries identified as their leader. But also there was the workings of the British constitutional system, which was a very important factor, and a whole number of people who all supported Jinnah at that particular time. But one must look at the institutions that the British introduced, particularly the democratic system that created the that allowed Muslim League in the 1946 elections to claim to speak for Muslims of South Asia. In this regard, of course, one can analyze the story from many different perspectives. My own perspective is that I am the biographer of Liaquat Ali Khan, and I'm interested in party organization, the All India Muslim League, how they organized, the working committee, the committee of action, and all of the others. And I think there were many founders of Pakistan. There was undoubtedly one sole spokesman, but there were many founders. Liaquat Ali Khan was one, Harun of Karachi was another, Raju of Mahmudabad, Ispahani, Bengal. All of these people deserve consideration for helping to create Pakistan in 1947. And of course, perhaps above all, Congress blunders. One has to admire Muhammad Ali Jinnah's political strategy. I think in the pre-47 period, he only made one mistake. But Congress made two enormous blunders. One was in 1939 in resigning from the provincial governments, and the other was the Quit India movement, which put them in prison for the duration of the war and allowed the Muslim League to develop its strength. One can examine the creation not of a nation here in Pakistan, but of a state. And that, of course, has been the trajectory of modern history. The confluence, the coming together of a capitalist system with the state. And the two are harnessed together, and that is what, so if I may just be provocative and simplistic, I think the answer to the question is a state and not a nation.
Thank you, Professor Long. Your response to my question actually takes me back to the cabinet mission plan. And it is an often asked question, and it's not a new question. But if I may begin with you, that if Congress had agreed to the cabinet mission plan, then would there have been two nations or two states as a result after 10 years as the plan suggested or not? I mean, it's a...
Good question. For Jinnah, of course, it all depends how one wants to interpret the events of 1946, both the cabinet mission plan and the interim government. The Muslim League maintained all along that whatever arrangements they were making had the seeds of Pakistan. Now, whatever that meant is somewhat difficult to say, but what we do know from all of the speeches of Jinnah and all of the speeches of Liaquat Ali Khan and Khalique Zaman and all of the others is that they wanted equal power with the Congress. And also, I think that after 1945, neither Jinnah nor Liaquat nor any of the others really knew what they could get from the British. There have been few historians who have pointed out exactly how weak a position the Muslim League was in 1945. Sumit Sarkar was one of them. And what the British could have done, and which Congress wanted them to do, was simply to ignore the League, hand over power to the Congress, and leave. And Congress would take care of the whole problem themselves. So one of them said, I remember, like dealing with a younger brother. It is to Jinnah's credit that he bounced off of all of the different proposals and tried to negotiate for a stronger position. One suspects that if all that Jinnah could get was a strong federal system with the sort of ABC groupings that was offered at one time, he may have been forced to take it. Of course, we will never know. Although throughout, the phraseology which they used was, this has the seeds of Pakistan. What Congress wanted was what almost happened, and this was Jinnah's one mistake, I think, in this whole period. That was not entering into the interim government in September of 1946. And for one long month, Nehru was effectively the prime minister, Muslim League was not involved in the government, and many in the Congress were cock-a-hoop that they actually had power, they actually had control of India. Nehru was having his afternoon tea parties with his cabinet, and they had achieved what they really wanted to achieve, which was power without the Muslim League being involved. The British at that time could have said, well, if you're not prepared to take part in these negotiations seriously, then we simply hand over power to the Congress, which is exactly what Nehru was advocating, exactly what Patel, who had a very important role in this period, was advocating. So I think it all depends how you interpret the cabinet mission plan. It's only historians like us who make predictions, and that is, we predict the past. And so it is easier for us to do so. But Jinnah was acting on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, to the various strategies that was coming at him.
Khan Saab, if I may ask you, as we see, and I'm a student of literature and a very minor student of history, the premise for partition was bringing peace to South Asia, wasn't it? You can't live together. You have two different states, two separate states to live in. And I recall Qaid-e-Azam Muhammad Ali Jinnah giving an interview to a foreign journalist and telling that journalist that he will retire to Bombay. So what is your take on that? Why did peace did not come even after partition? Because we see that partition actually, some of us say that partition actually began in 1947. Yes, it hasn't ended. I mean, we are separating and getting further away from each other in some ways, politically particularly. So why did that not happen?
Sorry. The things which happened immediately after partition. The things which happened immediately after partition. First of all, the riots in Punjab, the whole migration, people were affected, and which resulted into the killing of Gandhi, this migration of refugees and all that. They were so... The other thing is that Jinnah gambled after independence. He accepted the Junagarh accession, and then he couldn't argue on that constitutional basis, which he was very good to do it on Kashmir. When you accept Nawab of Junagarh as accession, 85% Hindu majority, you couldn't fight it out. But Nehru was weak because they were also intriguing in Kashmir. They were also creating problems. So he surrendered and he said, we will have a plebiscite. But he didn't do it. And moreover, I still believe that partition did not come through consent. So peace didn't come. It was just forced on, definitely on Jinnah. And he had no alternative but to accept it. And then here, after that, in Pakistan, a new setup ruled instead of federal secular democracy, Liaquat Ali Khan's objective revolution, and the whole Islamist thing. So for 70 years, they are prevailing it. The whole history and narration has changed. I have seen the official documentary by government of Pakistan that Pakistan came when Muhammad bin Qasim arrived. So this is the position we have taken for 70 years. It is a very good unit from Peshawar to Karachi. It's the ideal country if it is run as a federated state. But unfortunately, the people who have taken over, they talk about Islam, which they are not able to explain, and that brings more conflict. And moreover, the Islamic leadership and Pakistan people don't realize that they have left not the better half, at least half of Muslim population in India, and they should do something, some way, which helps them. But their every action here creates problem for the Indian Muslims. And Indian Muslims also decided. Of course, Congress is responsible for the partition of the country, so saying that... And naturally, there couldn't be peace when two enemies together come for arrangement.
Professor Jalal, you have a lot to comment on.
Well, let me first say this, that partition occurred because of the failure of a power-sharing arrangement that would have resolved the conflict that you talked about. Now, conflict resolution is one thing. Partition was deemed to be conflict management because the Muslim League and the Congress could not agree on a power-sharing arrangement. Now, conflict management, at least those of you who know IR, will understand, is not necessarily resolution. And partition effectively ensured that there would be no conflict resolution, given the fact that it led to not just the bloodbath of 47, but the creation of two hostile nation states. And so I think it's worth considering whether partition as a method of conflict management has not in itself become the major obstacle to conflict resolution. So I would say that. And the second point I want to make, I mean, I would love to talk about the cabinet mission plan, but we've already had a lot on that. What I would like to say is that partition is not an event that happened in 1947. Yeah. Partition is a process that has a history prior to 47 and a history after 47. And as we speak, partitions are happening in our midst, not just partitions between India and Pakistan, but within Pakistan, within India, the way we demarcate difference, the way we exclude people, that is partition. Partition is the failure of conflict management, conflict resolution. And as a result, what was being attempted? Partition was a product of the failure of power sharing. And, you still have to learn to live with each other. And that's exactly what is missing when you create a nation-hyphenated state. So, I mean, another nation-hyphenated state was created in 71 because of the failure to make power-sharing arrangements. So I think that's basically what it is. But what is worse for everyday life and for citizens are the partitions we create in our own midst every day, the way we look at people, the way we other people, the way we deal with difference. Those are the partitions we are creating ourselves, because we have actually imbibed the logic of partition as it happened in 47. So partition is a process. It's happening as we speak.
Thank you very much. And now, as I said at the outset, we'll open the floor now.
It's a very
good
idea.
We'll take questions. But I would request that you keep your questions short and to the point. And also, if you can identify who you are asking this question from. Let me begin. You tend to begin with the left, but let me begin with the right on this occasion. Ji, Adim Saab. Junaid Saab. Beta, microphone dijiye.
I am Abdul Khalik Junejo, a political worker. My question is from Ayesha Jalal. You as a historian and also you are a teacher, so you may teach us. Is it possible to mention a specific date of birth of a nation like a human being as Haris Khalik? And can a nation be created through negotiations between different people? And third part is that whether Pakistan is a nation state or a multinational state.
Thank you, Junaid.
Well, these are all very abstract questions. I can be a little bit more concrete and say that yes, in terms of negotiations that Professor Long talked about between the British and the Congress and the Muslim League, whether Jinnah had to acquiesce in the creation of Pakistan, nevertheless, negotiations occurred. And yes, a nation state was born based on the 3rd June partition plan. So, that is still conceivable, whether you say that that's what Mr. Jinnah had been fighting for all along or was made to acquiesce in is a different issue. So I think that would be my response to you. And in terms of, sorry, what was the second part of the question? A nation?
Is that a multinational state?
Is Pakistan
nation
a nation state? Pakistan is a diverse modern nation state. That's what I would say. There are multiple identities in this country, some of which could be described as nationalities. That's a subjective perception. It's not for me to say whether there are six nations in this country, but I can just say that it is a diverse, multi-linguistic country, and that diversity all has to be part and parcel of the accommodative process in this nation state. It's not so unusual. There are many, many nation states in the world that have, look at India, it's a diverse, multi-national state, and you could say the same for Pakistan, but it's a question of definition, how you're defining it. Okay. So I would say the diversity is where I would go, that it's a diverse nation state.
Right. Lady in the fourth row.
Sayeed Khan, you mentioned the objectives resolution. Liaquat Ali Khan, what prompted him to do that? Wasn't he fairly secular, inverted commas, that sort of thing? And what is the objective resolution's problem with people today?
I think the reason for all these politicians who came after Jinnah was that they had no influence on the public. Muslim League had collapsed totally. Even before Jinnah, it was Jinnah, not the Muslim League. Wherever he was, people were following him. The position was this, that people around, politicians around, that we have to use the word Islam. And for that, they have to compromise the Maulvis. During the elections, Jinnah also compromised. But Jinnah tried to reject that thing in his speech. But 46 election, he called these peers, these mullahs and all that. And we failed to tell to the people that real orthodoxy of Islam was opposed to this creation. People who were the mullahs, the alims who came to Pakistan were not the first great one. They were not Deoband's top people. Shabbir Ahmad Usmani had already left. And if you read Sayyid Sulaiman Nadvi's lecture, which are about 10-12 lectures, which are not available in Pakistan probably, but they are available in India, in which he says ki Hindustan hamara hai, hamare tamam sufia yahan aaye hain, yahan rehte hain, Hindustan, sara Hindustan mein musalman raha hai, aur according to him Hazrat Adam bhi yahi utre hain, meaning Sri Lanka hai, but it is the continent. Magar phir to sahara lena shuru kar diya, prompts ki baat hi nahi hai, phir har ek ne sahara liya. Aur phir ye bahut si baatein kehna padti hain majbooran, one may believe it or not believe it. Chaudhry Khalique Uzama sahab Hindustan gaye hue the, wahan se wapas aaye, to I was chauffeuring him round. To Raja Gajan Far Ali ke paas milne gaye, to Raja sahab ne unhe dekhte hi, jab kaha jata hai jhappi mari, और फिर कहा कि कहो क्या हाल है, और फिर आधी उर्दू और आधी अंग्रेजी, आधी उर्दू और आधी पंजाबी में राजा साहब ने फरमाया उनसे कि ए दसो ये मामला ख़त्म कब होगा. दिस इज़ 1960 एंड टू स्टॉलवर्ड्स ऑफ द पाकिस्तान मूवमेंट आर टॉकिंग इन दिस लैंग्वेज. मैं 20 मिनट तक सुन रहा था, फिर मैंने पूछा चौधरी साहब से कि ये इससे आपका क्या मतलब. बोले यही 150, वो उन्होंने एक्सप्लेन किया राजा साहब को, और फिर मैंने पूछा कि ये जो 150 मील का टुकड़ा बीच में रह गया है इसकी वजह से दिक्कत हो रही है. तो फिर मैंने पूछा उनसे, तो मैंने कहते साहब या इससे आपका क्या मतलब है. तो फिर उस पर उन्होंने कहा कि बात यह है कि दिल्ली, लाहौर से लेके दिल्ली तक कोई मुसलमान नहीं रहा. सो देर इज़ ए बफर between Pakistan and India, and we can't negotiate, we can't talk, and we can't meet. Aur phir aisa hi ek personal baat hai, that again amounts to rejection. Tom Driver, a British politician, I was living in London in certain area where Mountbatten was not living very far. So he came to see me, Tom Driver. So I asked him, where are you going? He said, I'm going to see Mountbatten. I said, can you take me? He said, of course, come along. So I went along to see Mountbatten with him. Mountbatten was talking, he was nostalgic and all that. I cannot repeat that word here, four-letter word, but what he used, Mountbatten, meaning that I made a mess of it. He didn't accuse any but Indian politician. He said, I made a mess of it.
Well, I must add that he certainly spent the rest of his career and life trying to claim credit for the greatest administrative operation in history. So whatever he said to you was completely contrary to how he projected it.
Of course, yes.
We've got ample time, don't worry. Before you ask your question, if I may be allowed to say just a couple of words about the change that was introduced in the objectives resolution in 1985. So there was a word freely which was expunged. In the objectives resolution, there's a clause about minorities practicing and preaching their faith freely. The word freely was removed in 1985. An objectives resolution was made the substantive part of the constitution.
Of the preamble.
Preamble to pehle bhi tha, 73 mein bhi tha. They, addendum ke taur pe add kar.
But I just want to say one thing about the objectives resolution which wasn't said, and that objectives resolution basically was perceived at that stage as really a victory for the establishment, the quote-unquote secular establishment, at a time when there were a lot of demands on the Muslim League and Liaquat Ali to basically cave in to the demands of the very elements who had opposed Pakistan that were being mentioned, the more orthodox religious elements. So I think that it's important to realize that what was seen as a success story still contained that clause which said that the government will be held responsible for enabling, creating a Muslim environment, enabling environment for the Muslims of this country. Now that provided the space. But it is important for us to remember that in the context of 49 politics, it was a victory for Liaquat Ali Khan and the forces of quote-unquote moderation.
Right.
So I would like to just place that, and it's subsequent policies, and also don't forget that it took a long time from 49 to 73 to 83 for the situation to get more complicated. So context is all important. I mean, what I'm trying to get at is that the objectives resolution could have gone any way, and it did. Why did it take so long for this process to unfold? And I think maybe you could add a few things here.
I mean, first of all, even when I like what Professor Jalal is saying, that is true, that Liaquat Ali Khan tried to explain it, that it is secular. But there are speeches of people like Sayyid Suleiman Nadvi that don't be tripled. How can we live with Hindus? How can we give him the equal citizen? All these people's speeches are there. So that dialogue had started then, you know. And then it was not only the objection resolution, things went bad to worse after that. In Bengal, we used the same language, Islam versus others. Bengali were not Muslim for us in that fight. So we kept on using it. Or for 70 years, Islamists are ruling this country in various forms, whether they are in the name of democracy or whether in the name of dictatorship. Ayub Khan tried to do it for a thing, then he had to world it. So they are ruling it. Now it's a time that a need of a federal economic state on secular lines. That's the only way to survive.
Professor Long, would you like to add something here, or then we'll take the question?
No. Times change, as Dr. Jalal has said. And in 1949, Liaquat obviously thought he had time. He had no idea he just had two more years to live. And when he came up with a lot of opposition to the objectives resolution, he thought that he had time to try to bring different parties together. And of course, as Dr. Jalal said, interpretations of what was good Muslim practice differed from today than they did in 1949. Exactly. And the key word is not so much Islamic, but Muslim.
Yeah.
Liaquat Ali Khan, all his life, fought for Muslim educational opportunities. He fought for Aligarh Muslim University. And when he came back from Oxford in 1922, he would recite Iqbal's Jawab-e-Shikwa off by heart. As a committed Muslim, but certainly one would not call him Islamic. And the mood, I think, in 1949 is very, very different as it has been from the post-1979 period. Yeah. So one has to put it in, as Dr. Jalal has said, one must put it in historical perspective and try to imagine how the people were imagining things at that particular time. But Liaquat was a more patient person, and certainly he thought he had time to try to bring the different influences together to come up with some kind of compromise that would be in some future constitution.
Thank you, Professor Long. Gentlemen in the seventh row, yes, please.
My name is Azmat Baloch.
If you can speak into the microphone.
I am a social and human rights activist. So, Haris, I'm sorry, actually all the conversation was revolving around our school books, I think. My questions to Ayesha Jalal, to the best of our understanding is we were taught Pakistan has been created in name of Islam, a religion. Islam is a faith. And it can be a brotherhood, not a nationhood. If it can be a nationhood, so do you think a faith can be the base of nationalism?
Okay. Well, first of all, I think that it's important to make a very fundamental distinction between ideology, that is what is taught in the textbooks that you are referring to, and history. Having said that, I think it's important to also realize that as has been pointed out, that Pakistan was created as a homeland for Muslims. When you say it was created in the name of Islam, what does that mean? Because clearly the battle between the Muslim League and the Congress was not on definitions of God. We were not having a theocratic debate. We didn't divide. It was a political problem. So I think it's important to know what you're talking about. They were not discussing faith in terms of Islamic interpretations or conceptions of God. We were talking about political power. It was about the Muslims of India and their share of power in an independent India that was being talked about. So when you say it was created in the name of Islam, it generates confusion in the minds of people thinking that it was meant to be that theocracy, which in fact your leadership of the nationalist movement fought tooth and nail to resist. And I can go on, but I won't, because Mr. Jinnah resisted the advice of Raja of Mahmudabad, his main financier, to commit to an Islamic state, and he resisted, even though, please correct me, Raja Saab was the only one that he ever entertained in a lavish 400 plus dinner at his home, and he never used to do that, and he yet rejected what Raja Mahmudabad recommended. He did the same to Nawab Bahadur Jung in 43. So I think that it's important to understand the difference, first of all, between Islam and Muslim, as was pointed out, and that the struggle for Pakistan was to enable the Muslims of India to have an equitable share of power in an independent India. To say that this was about Islam creates this confusion that you were fighting some kind of a war crusade on religion. But religion was not being discussed. You were not discussing the tenets of religion.
Thank you. We take a question.
First of all, I would like to let him finish.
Raja Mahmudabad was staying with Mr. Jinnah, and there is a place, Mathran or something, some hilly area near Bombay. And he went there, and he spoke, and he said that Pakistan mein Quran ki hukumat hogi. So when he came and Jinnah learned about it, he said, Amir, his name was Amir, Amir, what rubbish nonsense you have been talking. And the second word, I will not use it. The second sentence, I will not use it, what he said it. And what a rubbish talk. He was an emotional man at that stage. Raja Sahib started arguing it, and that he himself told me. He said, then I found out that train to Lucknow was about 10 hours away. So I left the house. I walked on the streets of Bombay for about eight hours. And then in the night, I got the train and went to Lucknow. And then after a year, when the elections were coming, Jinnah called me. And there are letter addressed to Isfahani, in which Jinnah said, where Amir is sulking, send him back to me. So he went back to him, and he said, then I went. And that letter is published.
Right. जी बेटा इधर
ओके फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल
मैं देख लिया आपको आप बैठे आराम से आ रहा हूं आपके पास सो देयर मेनी पीपल सो आई विल कम टू यू डोंट वरी
While preparing for civil services exam I had to study a version that Pakistan Civil Service Academy and Federal Public Service Commission want us to write in the exams and while reading entire course I got to know that what Mr. Roger is saying is actually what we are taught but if we see the other version of history that is presented by Mr. Aziz who gave in the murder of history we see that Mr. Liaquat Ali Khan was nowhere and he was not the choice which Jinnah made later on but what my question to Ms. Jalal is that we have talked about everything but I want to know that Mr. Jinnah previously while he was working and struggling for the Muslim rights in constitutional Muslim rights in India like one third majority in the provinces and everything and continuously even in his 14 points talking about the minority rights that same Mr. Jinnah wants to end provincialism in Pakistan and preach that there should not be this differences in among the provinces and every like all provinces should work like a unified system and also trying to impose a language of a minority on the majority so see, these all things and with that his a change in attire from the awesome suits to sherwani in these all ceremonies which he attended later on we have seen a conflict of thought and a conflict of interest in the policies of Mr. Jinnah so I want your comment yes, on that
again,
thank you so much
I would say that if you were to make a distinction between ideology that you are being taught and history I don't think the confusion would be that great as far as Mr. Jinnah is concerned Mr. Jinnah did speak about the plague of provincialism because there's a difference between talking about minority rights in the context of India and once state formation in Pakistan became the key issue. There, I think that I myself have pointed out that, I mean, context matters. I think the first 6 months of Pakistan were very, very dicey and there was no certitude that it would survive. And so I do think that as Governor General, he took some actions including the decision to dismiss the NWFP government and then of course his decision to impose Urdu on the Bengalis. I thought that was a very insensitive policy on his part. But I think there's a world of difference between these policy decisions on his part and his complete commitment to the rule of law as a constitutionalist. So I think to say that he made these concessions and therefore what transpired later on is justified because even the founder of Pakistan did that is to misunderstand history and again read history from the ideological perspective and not place him into context. I think once you place him into context, you realize that the man was trying to ensure that this country, now that it has been created, will survive. And for that, he did feel that unity was important. It was not so unusual, given the discourses of nation states. In that sense, it might help you to sort of understand Pakistan as one among many nation states that have followed similar policies. But when you locate Pakistan's specificity, the murderous hatred that led to the creation of Pakistan, the fact that it was separated by 1,000 miles of Indian territory, the two wings of Pakistan, these are not so difficult. You can still criticize Jinnah, but at least have make the effort to contextualize him. Because when you don't contextualize him, you're providing your ideology. Not a historically grounded understanding of why he did something.
Thank you. My name is Danish Kazi. I'm a blogger. My question with Roger is, you mentioned that historians cannot go back, they cannot see the future, but they can only predict the past. And we have agreed, I think, here that the Pakistan as a nation was formed as two states, not on Islamic principles, because half the Muslims are still back in India. My question from you is, whilst you cannot predict the past, can you see that this region, which was demarcated based on ethnicity and other cultural factors, would you see this region, which we call South Asia, further dividing in the future?
I'm not sure I got the question, but Jinnah did not create Pakistan as an Islamic state. It was part of a ethnogenesis movement, if you wish to call it like that. And if you want to take a broader perspective, our modern history has been the history of identity politics. And this continues even today, even more so today, in spite of the fact that we are living in a global economy. Identity politics remain very, very strong and are getting even stronger. And technology, the internet, etc., make groupings based upon one's particular interest even more possible than in the past. Jinnah kept the definition of Pakistan vague and did not want to define it. He was constantly asked by the British and the Congress, how do you define Pakistan? But he refused to define it, and it came to mean many things to many people. To some of the peasants of North India in the UP, Venkat Dudipala has recently written about a new Medina. Many people thought that removing the British and this Pakistan would suddenly create a more wonderful way of life. A number of industrialists supported the Muslim League because they were happy to get rid of British companies they would have a more open market for themselves. Abu Kalam Azad writes 10 years after partition of how there was enormous confusion amongst many Muslims about what Pakistan actually meant. And people could interpret it in ways that they in ways that they wished. I think that that one has to look, as has been stated, at the historical context, at the historical perspective. But Jinnah did not define Pakistan as an Islamic state. He defined it as a Muslim state that would be open and welcome to everyone's. He employed Christians, he employed Ahmadis, and he employed everyone on a personal level. So,
thank you. I have, you know, we have got 10 minutes, and I'll take two questions.
I am a medical student and not that much aware of history. So can you please tell me the most significant benefit Pakistan had after partition that can we use to stop our hurt when it cries for all the losses that we hear that Pakistan suffered due to partition? What's the most significant benefit that Pakistan got after partition that we can use to stop our hurt for when it cries over all the losses we suffered with partition? I hope you got.
It's a very hard question to answer. I mean, it's sort of. I really don't have a response to that.
Can you make
Yes, I mean, you have the nation. Well, yes, you have the nation that Mr. Jinnah had attempted to create, even if only a sort of a version of it. I think he wanted much more. And I think that despite all that has happened, the ability to still see this as your own land and to be able to make something of it, it's your own, I think is a big difference, and that's why I always say that you know, you need to understand that whatever happened, however limited a victory it was for Mr. Jinnah, it is an achievement, and it has been up to us to make something of it. But if you continue to confuse yourself unnecessarily and continue to fight amongst yourself, you're not going to succeed. Where Pakistanis have failed is to has been to create institutions that can mediate our conflicts. We are going to be conflicted. We don't have to agree, but we can have the decency to disagree through mediational institutions. And that's what we have failed. Authoritarianism does not solve our conflicts. It only freezes them. And every time you defreeze, the problem comes back with, morphed into a bigger problem. So I think that's what you have to realize. So you have to appreciate this piece of land that is yours to make off as you wish.
I'll request brief questions and also brief answers from my esteemed panelists. Please.
My question is from Ayesha Jalal, because she knows the history. My mother was in the Constitution Assembly, and she was not happy with the objectives resolution, and she clashed with Liaquat Ali Khan because she said we should not have a clause that says a minority cannot become the head of the state. However, she lost. Am I correct?
Yes.
Yes, you're correct.
Yes.
Ji, please, yahan pe.
You are right that she lost. But the point I wanted to still make, and you know, politics is the art of the possible, if I may be allowed to say so, or the art of the possible. So in that context, he compromised. If you were to try to contextualize the debates around the Constituent Assembly at that time, I mean, if your head is not dizzied out of existence, you will realize that what happened, the result was a success for Liaquat, was perceived as, and please, you correct me because you were there.
You are right, but I don't think they will make it among the opposed people.
Well, then I think that's something that you, I will, but I think this question did come up about the minorities.
Yes, it did.
It's in the Constituent Assembly debates. I certainly have read that.
Joginder Nath Mandal also made a speech against it. Yes, please. Am I allowed 5 more minutes?
Yes.
Just one little question. One, how authentic is Jaswant Singh's book on partition? Second thing is that now we have the first generation of young people not looking over their shoulder what we left behind and what happened. And in the present scenario, I know as predicting the future, where do you see now history taking us with this new generation?
Well, I just want to comment on Jaswant Singh's book. The moment the book came out, the Indian media said that this was all said 25 years ago by Ayesha Jalal. And Jaswant Singh, who had been sending me his books before, forgot to thank me in that particular book. He subsequently has apologized, not to me, but in public at some stage, that I should have acknowledged her. But basically, it's a rehash of what I had argued earlier. But what is significant about Jaswant's book, which nobody really talks about, is the fact that it is dyed-in-the-wool Hindutva interpretation of Indian history. To miss that and to go on to the Jinnah issue, why is he so fascinated? I think partly because Jaswant Saab sees himself as a bit of a Jinnah in the BJP, or he did, because he's also sort of, you know, he has that attitude. And so I think in that sense, Jinnah is a bit of an icon for him. But I think that you have to contextualize the book, which should have been much better edited by Rupa than it is. I think it's a really badly edited book. But having said that, it is very much a Hindutva point of view. So I don't think that you should miss that in talking about how he uses Jinnah to make a point against the Congress effectively. Because, I mean, you know, he came to see me when I was in Delhi, precisely on the point about communalism and, secularism, saying that, you know, we're all for secularism and they call us communalists, just as they call Jinnah a communalist. So I think that is partly, but it is all part of the Hindutva ideology.
Haris, my name is Majid Siddiqui. I am a journalist and a writer myself. I am writing for different publications. जब हम fall of Dhaka के perspective में बचपन से जब हमने कोई debate सुनी है तो उसमें कहा जाता है कि it was the West Pakistan which actually tried to subjugate it Bengalis, और West Pakistan ने Bengalis को उनके rights नहीं दिए. लेकिन जब हम हिस्ट्री की किताबें पढ़ते हैं तो हम देखते हैं कि इवन ड्यूरिंग द जिनाह डेज जिनाह साहब डिड नॉट गिव प्रेफरेंस टू द बंगालीज. यानी जब कैपिटल सेलेक्ट किया जाता है तो वो वेस्ट पाकिस्तान में होता है. जब लैंग्वेज सेलेक्ट की जाती है तो वो एक جو مائگریٹڈ لوگوں کی جو لینگویج ہوتی ہے اس کو نیشنل لینگویج قرار دیا جاتا ہے. پرائم منسٹر ویسٹ پاکستان سے ہوتا ہے جس کے ساتھ ان کے بعد میں اچھے ریلیشن بھی نہیں رہتے.
مختصر آپ کی آپ کا
اچھا ڈسپائٹ آف دیٹ کہ ہی نیو دیٹ دیٹ سول اینڈ آرمی بیوروکریسی بلانگ ٹو دا ویسٹ پاکستان. تو ہسٹری ہمیں اصل میں بتاتی ہے کہ ایون ڈیورنگ دا جناح ڈیز مطلب جناح کے دنوں میں ہی اسٹارٹ ہو گئی تھی وہ پروسیس جس کا اینڈ ہوا 1971 16 دسمبر فال آف ڈھاکہ. واٹ از یور ٹیک آن اٹ؟
I mean, I would sort of disagree with you on the grounds that context matters. And yes, policies were made. I do personally think that his view on the language, it was never the national language, it was the official language. There's a big difference between national language and official language of the state. So I think Mr. Jinnah was talking again from the point of view of state formation. He was insensitive to Bengali sentiments, Bengali's cultural sensitivity to their wonderful literature and tradition. It was an insult to them. And they resisted, as they should. But to say that Mr. Jinnah flouted constitutional norms to impose certain things, even the dismissal of Khan Sahab's ministry, was constitutional. It was not unconstitutional. So you cannot blame the unconstitutional acts conducted in the later part of Pakistan's history onto something that Mr. Jinnah had started. I would disagree with that strongly.
Jinnah called the law secretary. His name was Sir Ian Snelson. And he said, I want you to write the constitution of Pakistan and to give the maximum autonomy to East Pakistan. Right. He wanted to go back. He was not happy. So he refused. But he gave an outline, which unfortunately is not available in the archives of Pakistan. What is available in the so-called archives of Pakistan is Jinnah's diary, which was used by General Zia and Sharifuddin Pirzada.
Right. So don't
be short. Yeah, very short. Dr. Jalal, read your book, can't get a question out of my mind. Why in the world did Mr. Jinnah want to become the sole spokesman? At what point did he decide to become the sole spokesman? Or was it a decision that he never made? And very quickly, you write that Jinnah was forced to put his demands in communal terms after 1937, but before that, if Mr. Jinnah is representing a minority and only that minority, and that minority happens to be a community, then was not Mr. Jinnah a communal leader from the day he decided to become the sole spokesman?
Completely wrong-headed interpretation of history, first of all. I think that Mr. Jinnah's being a sole spokesman was an aspiration. Much like being a democratic, moderate nation is an aspiration for Pakistanis. It was an aspiration, and why did he demand to be the spokesman? Because he knew that his Muslim constituents were pulling in 50 different directions, and that if he was going to present a case, it had to be a coherent case. So it was an aspiration to want to be the sole spokesman of Indian Muslims. And that's basically something that you have to know. Now, on the basis of communal, now what is communal? Communal in the Indian context of India, everything matters is context matters. In the South Asian context is a pejorative word for what is not nationalism. So communalism was the failure of Indian nationalism to come into its own. Now so it was pejorative. But if you read, and there's a lot of work, including my own, on communalism, and I wrote a piece called Exploding Communalism, pointing out that who was communal was a political matter. So long as you were within the Congress and had the most bigoted points of view, you were a nationalist leader. But the moment you were opposing the Congress, you became a communalist. So I think that's extremely important. So that's what Mr. Jinnah said in March 1940, that the word communalist has become a play of thing in politics. You can call a communalist whoever you like. So in a sense, his decision to demand Pakistan was a revolt against Muslim minority status and being called a communalist. I think that's what you have to understand. He was articulating the Muslim demand for a Pakistan, which was a demand for Muslim rights in India, but he was asking for rights of all Indian Muslims. Pakistan was meant to be the umbrella that he spoke about in so many words that would also protect Muslims in the rest of India. He wanted such a Pakistan, but the politics of the situation made sure that the Pakistan you got was based on not a partition of India so much as a partition of Punjab and Bengal.
Thank you.
That is the real partition.
Thank you. Thank you, RS, for looking at your left. My name is Sagar from Hyderabad. I would ask you that, can you please comment on this, that partition of Indian subcontinent is justified in the light of two nation theory, keeping in view that many Muslims left in India after partition?
Khan sahab, would you like to take that question?
Yes, but this is already decided that partition was forced. It was not the geographical map of Jinnah. Partition was forced on Jinnah, and at that stage he had no alternative but to accept this partition of the country. And we, in general sense, we always use the word partition. We don't talk of independence. So that is our psychology. That's what we do, you know. It was the partition of Muslims, of course, no doubt. But it was there. Jinnah was all the time. He tried so many times to have a constitutional arrangement with Congress. Till 1946, he was trying a federated India. The word Pakistan was not in 40 resolution. And even in 40 resolution, if it is totally accepted, then there would be 55% Muslims in Punjab and equally in Bengal, not a big majority of Muslims. What Congress was dishonest is saying it when Jinnah much earlier told Congress, they reserve the seats for the Muslims in Punjab and Bengal and I will accept joint electorate, which they didn't.
Thank you. Thank you very much, panelists and ladies and gentlemen. This was perhaps the concluding session on partition and independence, and thank you all very much for being here this afternoon. And I apologize to those whose questions I couldn't take because of the paucity of time. Thank you.